गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन।
गुड इवनिंग मैम।
एम आई
गुड
क्लियर?
इवनिंग मैम। गुड इवनिंग
यस,
मैम।
गुड इवनिंग
ओके
मैम। सो फॉर द लास्ट क्लास आई लॉस्ट माय कनेक्शन, सो आई कुडंट कंप्लीट द पीपीटी। आई होप यू हैव गॉन थ्रू द पीपीटी व्हिच आई सेंड।
यस मैम।
हाउ डू यू फाइंड इट? व्हाट अबाउट द लास्ट पार्ट? We were discussing word formation, didn't we?
मैम
We were discussing word formation, weren't we?
यस मैम।
So we started with inflectional morphology, which is actually not part of word formation. Word formation starts with derivational morphology. So derivation is a very important process of word formation, and after that we saw conversion. I hope you remember what is conversion. What is conversion? Can anyone tell me what is conversion? Can anyone tell me what is conversion? It's again a very important type of word formation. I hope you all you know what is derivation. You create new words by taking affixes, either prefix or suffix. What is special with derivation? Derivation either changes the part of speech or changes the meaning. Isn't it so? Am I clear?
Clear, ma'am.
But I'm not getting any response. Can anyone tell me what is conversion? It isn't conversion that we stopped, or rather, I lose my connection. A word doesn't undergo any change, rather it is being converted. For example, the word beggar, it's a noun which can be converted as a verb. So the noun beggar can be used as a verb also. So this process is called conversion. And I gave you the example of a picture, the picture beggar description. That means beggar is a converted word. Actually, it is a noun which is converted as a verb. Is the idea clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so I'll continue with the rest of it. I'll go a bit fast because I have to start another vlog today. So I'll be going a bit fast. I thought you would read it, but you didn't read. Why didn't you read? I think I sent you the message as well. I wanted all of you to read the PPT. That's why I sent that to you. Anyway, let's continue with the PPT. Shall we continue with the PPT? Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So conversion is over. Now we will move on to compounding. Is it visible?
Visible, ma'am.
So compounding, as you can see, is the process of creating new words. Or we have already seen the concept of compound words. Compound words are group of two, three morphemes, right? It's made up of two, three morphemes. But you can't simply combine two morphemes and get a compound word. Rather, there are certain rules to be followed in order to create compound words. So while we discuss compounding, there are three approaches which need to be understood. First one is syntactic approach. Second one is semantic approach. And the third one is syntactic and semantic approach, a combination of both these approaches, syntactic and semantic. As the name suggests, syntactic approach is based on the structure. Okay, so the classification is based on the syntactic category, that is the structure. So look at the words here. Is my camera on?
No, ma'am, no, ma'am.
So noun compounds, adjective compounds, and verb compounds. If you look at noun compounds, you can see that the compound word is a noun, which is a combination of two nouns, right? Girlfriend, ice cream, see? It's a combination, ice cream. Take the word ice cream. It's a combination of two nouns. So noun compound means the compound will be a Now, when we again have a noun compound with the combination adjective plus noun, look at the word dark room. So again, a combination of dark, which is an adjective plus noun. So when you look at these words, you can see that the second morpheme gives the name of noun compounds or adjective compounds or verb compounds. Let's take an example from adjective compound. So we can have an adjective compound made of two adjectives, made of, for example, adjective plus adjective, icy cold, deaf mute. So these compounds are made of two adjectives, icy cold. Icy is an adjective, cold is another adjective. Look at the last one, verb compounds. So the compound will be basically a verb, which can be made up of a noun plus verb, an adjective plus adjective, and a verb plus verb. So let's take the example of a verb compound, which is a combination of two verbs. Sleepwalk, sleepwalk, right produce. Look at the word right produce. Both are verbs. So you get a compound word by combining two verbs, right produce. Is the idea clear? So the syntactic approach tells you the structure of compound words. So next one is semantic approach. Again, semantic, as the name suggests, it's about meaning, or it is based on signification. Can range from independent signification to dependent signification. Signification is the meaning that we get from the compound. So look at the first, look at the four words which I have given there. Hot dog, ice cream, girlfriend, Indian American. So if you look at the words, you can see that's combination of, again, two, three morphemes. But here the ideas are based on meaning. So you can't, you are simply not combining two words. Rather, for some words, the signification is completely independent. For example, hot dog. The word hot dog has nothing to do with the dog, right? But in the case of Indian American, the signification is fully dependent one. In the case of girlfriend and ice cream, you can't completely see that it is it is a compound word which fully relies on the two three morphemes. Rather, it has got a special meaning. At the same time, it is kind of related to the three morphemes which are being combined. Is the idea clear? For example, girlfriend. You can't call every girl as your girlfriend, right? But that's a special kind of girlfriend. It can be a lover also. So girlfriend is not a friend. It's not just a friend. Rather, it's a special kind of friend. So you, in that girlfriend, you can see, in the case of girlfriend, you can see that the signification is neither completely dependent nor completely independent. But in the case of hot dog, the signification is completely independent. While in the case of Indian American, the signification is almost dependent. Is the idea clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. So based on the signification, we have two types of compounds, endocentric compounds and exocentric compounds. If you can get the signification from the word, or the head of the compound represents the center, we call it endocentric compounds. That is, when you look at these words, you will see that the meaning or the signification, as signification lies in the center, dark room. The room is, so anyway, dark. Girlfriend, the friend is anyway girl. Blackboard, the board is anyway black. So they are endocentric compounds. That means the head represents the center. But in the case of exocentric compounds, there is no center at all. So there, you can't guess the signification from those words. Highbrow, red tape, turncoat, tall boy. So these compounds give you no signification at all. So there is no center. Okay, clear?
Again,
that has nothing to do with your bros. Highbrow is not something related to bro. Rather, it means an aristocratic person. Turncoat is like an opportunist. You have nothing to do with coat there. So these are examples for exocentric compounds. Okay, clear? Then the third approach, which is also called a generative approach, is a combination of both approach, syntactic and semantic approach. So, but here
first,
we try to
generate. First one is that is syntactic is structure based, and semantic is meaning based.
Semantic, always the word semantics means meaning. Syntax means structure. So syntactic is based on meanings. Sorry, syntactic is based on structure. Semantic is based on signification.
Again, please, ma'am, that endocentric and exocentric.
Endocentric compounds means you will get the head of the compound at the center. That means you can get the signification from the word itself. But in the case of exocentric, for example, dark room, you'll understand at least that Window, it's a compound word. The signification is at the center, dark. The room is anyway dark. Okay, but in the case of exocentric compound, there is no center at all. That's why I gave you an example of Hybro or a tall boy. Tall boy is not a boy who is very tall. Rather, it means a chest of drawers.
Turn coat.
Ah, Tom Ford. All these are examples.
Yes,
Then
ma'am.
right. Okay. Is it clear now?
Yes, ma'am.
So in syntactic semantic approach, you'll be given certain rules, general rules. So to determine the kind of compounding, nature of compounding. So here you can't simply combine two words. Rather, you try to generate certain sentences out of the compound. So you can have a compound word based on the structure as well as meaning. For example, in the case of sewing machine and fishing rod, you'll understand that it is a rod which is used for fishing. Again, in the case of sewing machine, you will see that it is a machine which can be used for sewing. Clear? But if you take the word, still there are certain complexities. So even you can't completely rely on this kind of approach because there are words like cleaning woman. You can't say that woman who is used for cleaning. Rather, it's a woman who cleans. Still there are certain complications. Similarly, there are words like hot dog, tall boy. I mean, this approach has difficulty in explaining the words like hot dog. A hot dog is not a dog which is very hot. Okay, so we can follow all these approaches, either syntactic, semantic, and we can even have a combination of both these or generative approach. So here we are given certain rules. We follow these rules to decide the compound, decide the nature of compounding. Clear?
Yes.
Next, we are moving on to so these are examples. Now, minor compound types. So there are some minor compound like coordinate type of compound, combining form compounds, dereduplicated type compound, and phase compounds. As you can see from the first one, coordinate type of compound means you have equally important compounds, morphemes, or the author and publisher. You can be an author as well as the publisher. But in the second of combining form compounds, the first word will not be used completely, rather, a part of which will be used socio-political. It's not social-political, rather, the first word is not complete, it is socio-political. Reduplicative means, again, you are repeating the word. Phrase compound means you are making a compound out of a phrase. He's more than usual interest. It's not a compound, actually, but you are creating a compound out of a phrase. Phrase is a group of words. It's more than usual interest. Spare me this detail. It's actually a phrase. Spare me the detail. So here, when you use spare me the detail, that phrase along with another word, look, it became a phrase compound. So phrase is used as a compound, a simple word. Here you get a phrase, but which is used as a word. That is what you mean by phrase compounds.
Okay, ma'am.
Clear? Okay, now moving on. Next is word coining. Word coining means again, you are given different types of word formation. First one, you start with back formation. Back formation, you create new words by dropping a part of it instead of adding suffixes. In case of derivation, we have added prefixes and suffixes. We either add prefix or suffix, or thereby you get a new word or you get a part of speech. But here, it is the opposite of derivation in the sense that you create new words by dropping a part of it instead of adding. Examples are beg, burger. Even though we may think that beggar is actually a word taken from beggar, it is actually we think bug is not beggar is a word taken from beg, but it's the opposite. Okay, so actually beg is a word which is formed out of back formation. Beggar was the word. Beg was derived from the word beggar through back formation. So the verb was created from the noun beggar. Actually, beggar, the noun beggar, which was actually used to denote a member of a mendicant brotherhood. They used to beg. So they were called a beghard. So beggar was actually a noun. Then we derived beg, the verb from the word beggar, by dropping that ER. Clear?
That means a teacher to teach.
No, not always. Not always. Not teacher. Teacher is actually formed through derivation.
Yes.
Beg, burgle, edit, hawk, peddle. These were used to show professions earlier.
That's why I told you the example of Bekaert, who was a member of Mendicant Brotherhood. Again, if you say singer, dancer, teacher, they're all created through derivation, not back formation. But in the case of beggar, burglar, these words were coined backward through back formation.
Any
Again, we
other
have
example, ma'am?
televise. It is taken from the word television. But revision is not example for back formation, it is derivation. So in order to understand this, you have to look at the history of the word. There can be
Yes,
two
ma'am.
reasons. First one is often there is something called the agentive suffix er, beggar, editor, hawker. So there is something called the agentive suffix er. It's not actually an agentive suffix in the real sense, but later it was accepted as an agentive suffix and thereafter they dropped it. That's why we have many words through back formation, like beg, burgle, edit, and so on.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, and then there is one more reason. When they were introduced, they already come with a suffix. For example, in the case of stage manager. So the verb, as we saw earlier, stage manage, is formed out of the word stage manager. So there was already an affix ia. Okay, so that word already had a er compound, that is a nominative agentive suffix. So when this verb is created out of it that er is dropped. So we get words like stage manager, then housekeeper. So stage manage and housekeep are words which are taken out of those two words, stage manager and housekeeper, through back formation. Okay, clear?
Yes.
Okay, next is reduplication. Again, as the name suggests, it's a repetition of a part, or can be repetition of a part, or it can be a repetition of whole of a root. So it is used to denote plurality. Again, we can use it to denote repetition or beauty of a word, intensity, continuation, size. Everything can be denoted using the repetition of certain sounds. So it can be repetition of a part or a whole of a root. For example, TikTok. Tick tock, tick tick, clump clump, quack quack. That's how you tell a child the noise of a duck. Quack quack, then goody goody. It's not actually used in a good sense, even though it's used in a pejorative sense. And hush hush. So we can have some words with phonological change. We have reduplication of the words with a phonological change, and also a change in meaning. So first is, if you take the example of rhyming compounds, in case of rhyming compounds like roly poly, there you can see that there is a change of consonants, but in certain case you can see a vowel change, as in ping pong, tip top. So there we see change of vowels, but in case of certain compound words you can see a change of consonants. Okay, so
this
there will
tick
be
tock ping pong is also comes under reduplication.
Exactly, TikTok. So the duplication is done through a vowel change, TikTok. So the vowel, internal vowel has changed.
Yes.
That is why I told you, it can be a repetition of a part or a whole of a root. Okay, clear?
Yes.
The next important word for much is blend. There are three types of blends: phono, isthmic blend, compound blend, and group forming blend. Let's take the first one, phono-isthmic blend. So it means you are combining phono-isthmic elements from two other words. So what is phono-isthmic element? Phono-isthmic means there is an occurrence of the same consonant cluster in a series of words. You can see consonant cluster. What do you mean by consonant cluster? Cluster of two consonants. Okay, pram, pray. So it's a cluster of PR. Then we have seen many examples of cluster of two consonant sound, three consonant sounds. Do you remember that? Sprinkle, it's a cluster of three consonant sounds. So here we see a cluster of consonants in a series of words. So they will all be conveying almost similar meaning. For example, crick, cramp, crinkle, they all suggest not straight. They all suggest the meaning not straight. Similarly, slide, slime, slip, slop, slim. So they all suggest kind of downward movement. So this is called a phono-isthmic blend. That means you are combining phono-isthmic elements from two other words. Phono-isthmic means you are combining consonant clusters in a series of words so that you will get a similar meaning. Clear? Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Next is compound blend. Compound blend is actually a well-planned, it's part of a well-planned coining. Okay, they share the same attribute of a compound word. Can you give me some example of a compound blend? Automantic words are all examples of compound blending. You're combining two words. You are combining some the attributes of compound. It's just like compound words. You're combining the attributes of two words, like when you
above
combine.
Board.
Sorry, I didn't get that.
Above board.
Above board. What do you mean by that?
ABOVEBOARD. Above board.
It's a combination of.
Combination of two different.
Actually, I'm not familiar with that word. Maybe smog. You can give smog as an example.
Like basketball.
No. It's not an example. See, when you combine two words which both carry the attributes, for example, when you combine smog plus foam,
ma'am,
you get
like,
the word
like.
Smog. Similarly, when you combine,
okay.
Exactly, liger, tigon, then brunch. It's a combination of breakfast plus lunch, brunch.
Okay.
Again, we have group. There is one more kind of blend, that is group forming blend. So first we have phono-isthmic blend, second we have compound blend, third is group forming blend. That means there is a significant difference between, usually there is a difference between prefix and suffix. But here we use certain suffixes which are added to the stem so that they will all give a similar meaning. For example, when you add CADE to a group of words, they will all get a similar meaning. Cavalcade, motorcade, camelcade, carcade, aerocade. So the meaning CADE means procession. So when you add this particular suffix ADE to a word, CADE to group of words, they will all get the same meaning. Clear? So motorcade is a procession of motor. Then camelcade is a procession of camels. That's how you get group forming blend. So when you using a particular suffix, you give the same attribute to a group of words. Clear? Is the idea clear?
Yes.
Now we will see clipping. Again, clipping are of three types: fore clipping, back clipping, fore and aft clipping. So again, here we are shortening a long word by dropping either the first part of it or the last part of it, or you can drop both part of it. So if you drop the first part of it, we call it fore clipping, and if you drop the back part, you call it back clipping, and if you can drop both the parts, both the front part and back part, you call it fore and aft clipping. Okay, can you give me some example for clipping? Fore clipping means you are dropping the first part of it. First morpheme.
Because we say cause. Is it the clipping, ma'am? Instead of saying because, we just blend it like cause.
That can be an example, even though it is not actually accepted in our written language. But bus can be an example. Bus. The real name is omnibus. If you drop the first part of it, you'll get bus, omnibus. Similarly, burger. Burger is actually hamburger, but we use only burger. Similarly, phone, telephone. Again, we have back clipping. An example would be cab. Cab is, the full form is cabriolet, but we use only cab. Again, America, they use doc. It's very common. Doc means doctor. Again, exam. Math. Math for mathematics. Exam for examination. Vamp for vampire. All these are examples.
Advertisement.
Then we have four.
Ma'am, advertisement.
Ad, very good. Advertisement, ad.
Gasoline and influenza.
Yeah. Then we have fore and aft clipping. Example is influenza. There we cut both the first and last part. So instead of influenza, we say only flu. Another common example is refrigerator. We use only fridge instead of refrigerator. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Now we'll move on to acronyms. Acronyms means you are forming words by taking the first letters of a series of words. So now acronyms, we call acronyms as an abbreviation turned words. We call abbreviation turned words as acronyms, like UNESCO, NATO, and so on. But we have another one more term coming here. BIBGIO. Then there is one more classification coming under acronym, that is abbreviation. So it is also called initialism. You take the initial letters of a group of words and you don't combine that words, rather you spell the letters like WHO, IBM, FBI, and so on.
Yes.
Okay. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
And now we will see the way words undergo a change of meaning. First one is generalization. Generalization can be done through two ways, that is through metaphorical extension and generification. You remember metaphorical extension? We have discussed this earlier. Metaphorical extension, you are figuratively extending the use of word. We discussed the concept of figuratively extending the use of a word. The mouth of a cave, do you remember that?
Yes, ma'am.
What is that concept called? Polysemy?
Yes, ma'am, polysemy, that was.
When you try to learn the difference between the lexemes, you saw the concept of polysemy. Actually, polysemy and metaphorical extension are almost same. The generalization means here what happening is a semantic widening of words. Semantic widening means the widening in the case of meaning, in the area of meaning. Sometimes the old meaning will be lost. Sometimes it will be generalized without affecting the meaning much. For example, manage. See, in olden time, we call manager as someone who handle a horse. But now manager comes to apply anyone who manages an office or anything. Someone with managerial skill can be called a manager. But earlier, it was used to call a person who handles a horse. Okay, again, this command polysemy. So there are two types of generalization, metaphorical extension and generification. Metaphorical extension means you are applying or you are describing certain ideas in terms of certain other ideas. Or rather, we can say that certain things from a field, certain things, objects or ideas from a field are described in terms of words from different fields. The best example is you often say, I can't digest the idea. Digest is not actually related to?
Biological one.
Thought. It is not related to thought. Rather, it is related to eating. But still, we apply it in another field. That is what is called a metaphorical extension, just like polysemy. That's why I started with polysemy. You are extending, you are figuratively extending the application of the word. Then I can't swallow your words. I'm swallowing this class. That means you may not like it, but still you are forced to swallow it. So swallow, digest, all these words are used in the area of or in the field of eating, but still when you apply to some other field, you call it metaphorical extension. Is it clear? In case
yes,
of in the so when it comes to generification, you are using a proper noun, you are generalizing a proper noun to represent an activity or a product. The best example is Xerox. Now for taking photostat, we call it Xerox. But Xerox was actually the name of the company. There's another example is Malaprop. Are you familiar with the woman Malaprop from Sheridan's Rivals? Mm-hmm. Who makes absurd combination of words. For example, for artillery, she would say adultery. That's how she makes use of words. An absurd use of words is called a Malaprop. That is how Malaprop used to make words. She was a character in Sheridan's Rivals. But now, whenever a person uses words in an absurd sense, we call the person as a malaprop. Then again, spooner. Have you heard of the name spooner?
No, ma'am.
Spoonerism is.
Yes, exactly. Spoonerism. Mm. What do you mean by spoonerism?
Jumbling or words used exactly, in jumbling order.
Jumbling. When you use words in a jumbling order, it is called a spoonerism. So I don't want to eat. I don't want to eat a whole worm. Instead of I don't want to waste a whole term. It's clear. That is how Spooner used to make sentences. This is called a spoonerism. We are jumbling certain sounds so that it would sound nonsensical to the listener. It's called a spoonerism. So Spooner, Malaprop, they are all characters or they are all proper names. But when you apply these proper nouns when you use it in a general sense to represent a product or activity, it is called a generification. Clear? Is it clear?
Yes.
The next is specialization. Specialization is the opposite of generalization. That means you are narrowing the meaning, narrowing the possibility of meaning. For example, pigeon. Pigeon earlier, it referred to any bird. But now pigeon comes to apply to a particular kind of bird. Again, deer. Deer was used to denote any animal. Now it is used to denote a specific animal. Then again, hound. Hound could be used to address any dog. Now it is a particular. Hound is used to call dogs which are completely meant for hunting. Clear?
Yes.
Clear.
Again, next important meaning change happens in the area of connotation. There is a change in connotation or association of meaning. So we have ameliorations and pejoratives. Ameliorations means words with negative connotations becomes less negative. Ameliorated, the betterment of words. So certain words will get better meanings. For example, earlier blame was a very negative word. It meant blasphemy, a word against God. But now we use the word very commonly. It's like, I don't want to blame you. But earlier when you use blame, that is related to God. Again, the word, another example would be nice. Nice earlier meant to represent ignorant person, but nice now has a very positive meaning. Okay, similar next idea is pejorative. In amelioration, words get a better meaning, but in case of pejorative, words get a negative meaning. Okay, an example would be villain. Villain earlier used to represent a serf. Serf was farmer, can be a person of a low class. Now it means a scoundrel. Okay, again, peasant was meant to be not a farmer earlier. Now it means an illiterate person. These are examples for pejoratives. I hope you understood it.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, that's all about it. I hope you understood the different types of word formation and what all ways a word can undergo change of meaning. See, the same question comes in second block also, history of language. There also we have the same idea, the different types of word formation, but there it is given in a much abbreviated manner. Here it is very vast. So you better rely on the second block if you are studying for the purpose of examination. In exam point of view, that is much shorter. Okay, now shall we move on to the next block? You have any doubt in morphology? If you're okay, let's move on to the first block. That's the history of language. Not history of language, what is language? Is it all okay?
Yes,
ma'am.
Yes. Okay. The PPT clear?
Yes, ma'am.
So this is how our first block is titled, General View of the Nature of Language. So the block begins with the definition of language. Let's see a definition by Oxford Dictionary. Language is actually a system of communicative words used by a community, or can be used by a people of society or in a country. And so we call language as a system of signs or a communication, system of communication. Almost similar definition is given here. Language is a system of sounds, words, pattern, etc. used by humans to communicate thoughts and feelings. So next question is, how did language originate? There are many theories which tell us about the origin of language. The first one is divine. So have you read the first block?
Yes, ma'am.
Have you read the first block, anyone?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So you must have gone through this part, the divine source theory, the natural sound source theory.
Yes, divine source, that means the Saraswati, that Adam and...
Very good, very good. That means human language originated as a gift from God, or rather language was created by God.
Yes, in Hindu mythology,
in tradition, that we call Saraswati the goddess of language. Very good, Saraswati. Yes. In Bible, it said that when God created Adam and Eve, he blessed them with language.
Yes, yes.
So that is the first theory. Then there is something called a natural sound source theory. This explains on the topic sound, words.
Yes.
Yeah, the first words were imitations of natural sounds, like cuckoo, hissing of the snake, buzzing of the bees.
Yes,
so that means there were basically onomatopoeic sounds. Then next one is ding-dong theory. What do you mean by ding-dong theory? Proposed by Max Muller. Language is, again, you must have seen this ding-dong theory. So language has originated out of a natural correspondence between object of sense perception and the vocal noise. So whenever you receive an external impression, you give it a vocal expression. Suppose when you hear the ringing of the bells, you naturally say the ding-dong, ding-dong. That's why the theory is titled ding-dong theory. So there is a natural correspondence between object of sense perception and the vocal noise, which were part of human reaction.
That means the sudden reaction comes under ding-dong theory, that means?
That means whenever you get an external impression, you try to give it a vocal expression. When you hear, yes, when you listen to the ring of a bell, you naturally give the response as ding-dong.
Yes,
okay.
Ma'am.
The fourth one is Yo-Hi-Ho theory. That's not given in your textbook. Yo-Hi-Ho theory means a language emerges from instinctive noises made by humans who are involved in collective rhythmic labor. That means language is a result of a rhythmic chant. So when people were involved in a heavy work, they will be making some grunts, like heave. They will be making some grunts. So language originated out of collective labor or rhythmic chant. When human beings were involved in collective labor, when they were pulling a wood, they must have made a sound. The language originated from collective labor. Okay.
Yes.
Next one is Tata theory. Again, as the name suggests, language came from the use of tongue and mouth gestures to mimic manual gestures. Tata, when you say, when you bid goodbye to someone, you might say Tata. It's the use of tongue and mouth gestures. You are combining tongue and mouth gestures to mimic manual gestures. That is Tata theory. Then next is Poo-Poo theory. That is given in your textbook.
Mimicry actually comes under natural sound source theory also, ma'am.
It comes under Poo-Poo theory. It comes under natural sound source theory also. When you try to mimic other sounds. Especially the sounds of nature.
Hmm.
Not if you are just mimicking another person's sound, it won't come under natural sound source theory. If you are mimicking a sound from nature, that will come under natural sound source theory.
Yes, ma'am.
So next is Poo-Poo theory. Again, you can see that a feeling of contempt. This theory is sarcastically titled Poo-Poo theory. Scornfully, the contemporaries of Darwin scornfully called this theory Poo-Poo theory. That means language, he said that language is developed from a primitive a form. That means it was an expression of emotion. That means whenever, when you feel a feeling of, when you have a feeling of contempt, you would use poo-poo. So it was an attempt of man to express his emotion. Okay, that is how, why this theory is titled poo-poo theory. So language emerged as a need for man's expression of emotion.
That means all these poo-poo, tata, these are all same, ma'am.
No, tata, in tata theory, you are combining both vocal sounds as well as gestures.
Oh, yes.
Okay. So poo-poo theory can be explained only in terms of your expression, that means sounds.
Yes, ma'am.
So in gesture theory, we are involving only gestures, or gestures preceded speech. So language was developed from gestures, which were the primitive form of communication, as opposed to vocal signals. So it evolved from manual gestures. So gestures preceded speech. Then last one is Lala theory. Lala theory, again, doesn't it sound very musical? Anyway, this theory says that language was born out of human need to express music, poetry, and love. That's why it is given the name of Lala. So music, we can even say that music preceded speech. So that emotion inspired music. So when they tried to express it through music, then that becomes, that is how language originated. That becomes the predecessor of language. That is what you mean by Lala theory. I hope this idea is clear.
Yes, ma'am.
So this question was asked many times. Explain the theories of the origin of language. Next question, this is also a very important question. It's very simple. At the same time, this question has been asked many times. Characteristics of human language. This question was asked as an essay question. Okay, so this is very important. It's very simple also. So what all things that distinguish human language from animal communication? What all are the features of human communication? First one is use of sound signals. What do you mean by that? We use sound signals. That is the most important characteristic of human language, as you all know. But we can't say that this is unique only to human beings. But we can say that this is very unique to human beings just because we use a lot of sound signals.
Yes.
Okay. Then, so this is a very important, so this characteristic, even though we can't say that this is completely unique to human being, but still it is a very important characteristic of human language, that is use of sound signals. Next one is arbitrariness, that is again very unique.
Very fast, everyone using the sound signal, every living being, but the human has maximum sound capacity, that is.
Not different types. Maximum, they have found infinite possibilities.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So animals will be following a particular pattern of signals, but in case of human beings, they are creating new sound signals every day.
Yes, ma'am.
Possibility is unlimited.
Yes.
Then next is arbitrariness. Again, this concept is very important because the next unit is dealing with structuralism. There also this concept becomes very important. That will come as a very important part. So arbitrariness, what do you mean by arbitrariness?
No logical relationship between word and the signifier and signifier.
Ah, very good. There is no natural connection between the signifier and signified.
Right.
So there is no connection between what we mean and what we say.
Yes, semantic and
pragmatic. But in case of animal, they will be simulating a particular particular sound which would be naturally connected, but in case of human beings there is no natural connection at all, because even when you call an apple by the name apple, it doesn't mean an apple, it doesn't actually convey an apple. Well, if you call an apple by any other name, the apple would remain as apple. I hope you got the idea. That means the name apple and the fruit apple doesn't bear any natural connection.
Yes.
So next is the need for learning. Again, this is a very unique feature of human communication. because when we grow a child, we will teach the child language. Because if the human child is brought up in isolation, it doesn't acquire language. That means we need exposure to language in order to communicate. It's very important for us to learn language. But Chomsky says that when you read Chomsky, when we discuss Chomsky, we'll see that he says human beings are born with an innate language acquisition, LAD. So again, environment also plays a very important role in triggering this ability. Okay, so it is part of us because we learn language to communicate. This is part of our learning process. Next is displacement. What do you mean by displacement? In case of animals, they can communicate things which are imminent or which are there. But in case of human beings, they can talk about things in their absence too. That is what you mean by displacement. You can talk about things in their absence. You can talk about America even if you have not been to America.
Yes.
Okay, displacement. Displacement means you can talk about things in absentia, in their absence. Next is creativity. As we see in the first one, use of sound signals, creativity is connected here because creativity means you can create, you can produce or create as many words or sounds as you want.
Yes.
That's why we are finding new words every day.
Yes.
But only thing is that it has to be accepted by the society. That's the only thing.
Yes.
Again, that is one of the characteristics that distinguishes human language from animal language. Next is duality or double articulation. What do you mean by duality or double articulation? Again, you have a set of sounds. Maybe sounds, you combine those sounds to get words. This is
that
called
is
a duality
words.
Or double. No, you have a set of sounds and you are combining those sounds to form words. This
yes.
double layering of language is called a duality or double articulation. So you have a layer of sounds. That is the first layer. Then you combine this layer. Then you, when you combine these sounds, set of sounds, you get words. This kind of organization in two layers is called a duality or double articulation. Okay, next is almost a similar concept, patterning. Again, patterning means you can't simply combine all the sounds to get new words. So there are certain rules to be followed. There are certain restrictions. The way we can combine those words, this is called a patterning. For example, CAT is a possible combination.
Yes.
But when you simply combine two words, it doesn't need to be a possible combination.
That means that convey particular meaning.
TCA is not a possible combination. Patterning means it
yes.
has to be patterned. You can't simply combine sounds, but it has to be accepted. So there are certain rules which are to be followed in order for those sounds to become meaningful. This
yes.
is called a patterning. Okay, clear. Next is structure dependence. Again, we depend on the structure of language. Again, this can be rearranged based on the rules of a language, but still you have to understand that the language is a structured chunk. That means a group of words stand for a structure. So that has to be arranged in a particular way. For example, in English, we arrange the subject in the first position followed by words and object. That's how we arrange the words.
That means patterning and structure dependence same, but patterning is
here
particular
it's a higher
word.
It's on a higher level. Sometimes
yes.
you can use passive voice to denote active voice. Active passive voice is another version of active voice. That way also you can produce the same sentence.
I yes, same meaning.
He was seen by me.
Yes,
that,
was,
that means that is again a acceptable structure.
Yes.
Okay. So you can arrange the structure, this structure according to the rules of language. Structure means group of words. So this group of words can be arranged according to the rules of language. An example is passive voice.
Yes.
So other characteristics are reciprocity. Reciprocity means a person, a speaker can also be a listener. Then next is rapid fading. That means auditory signals are transitory. They can disappear. They can vanish quickly. Next is spontaneous usage. You can speak without any compulsion. You don't need to be forced to speak. Then turn taking, again, as in the case of reciprocity, you take turns while you speak. The next is specialization. That means vocal signals are used for communication purpose only. They don't serve any other purpose like breathing, feeding, etc. The next is complete feedback. Since you can be the speaker, since you are the speaker or you can be the speaker, you get the feedback that time itself. When you say something, you'll get immediate response. That is complete feedback.
Yes.
Okay. Now, moving on to our next unit that begins with structuralism. Structuralism. So, this is a very important area. This question has also been asked many times. This is a very important question. Sorry, yes,
ma'am. In structure dependence, can we include all the grammatical rules as well?
Of course, the grammatical rules of the language in consideration. When you consider English language, the rules will be different. Based on the rules of the language, you can arrange the structure. In Malayalam, in case of Malayalam, you can follow any structure, that verb, noun, object, verb, subject, object, object, verb, subject, and so on. But in case of English, you have only two possibilities. One is as active voice and second is as passive voice. If there is object, if there is no object, you can't passivize the sentence.
Okay, so it does not include all the grammatical rules, like basically passivization process is included here.
See, I'm talking about the structure of language. Structure of language is formed based on all these rules.
Okay,
when you speak a language, you should know the rules and only you can produce sentences. That means language is basically about structure. Then what I told you was that if you want to have a structure of language, if you can have a different structure of language, but for that you need to check whether the rules permit for you to have the other structure.
Okay.
So, if the language permits only one structure, you have to follow that. If the language permits multiple structures, of course, you can do that. So, the structure is dependent on the rules of the language. Maybe for English, it won't allow for many combinations. But in case of Malayalam, it allows for you to have many combinations. For example, I told him can be expressed in many ways. Told him I, but in English it's not possible. Told him I, him, told I. These combinations are not at all possible. There are only two combinations possible. One is I told him, he was told.
Okay, ma'am. I got it.
Okay.
Thank you, ma'am.
So moving on to structuralism. Structuralism again is a school of thought that was developed in the 20th century in France. Educated through Strauss, anthropology structural. He was while he was studying the anthropological structure, that means he had some studies based on the anthropology. That means he studied the myth of different places. He understood that they all share something very common. In case of incest, I hope you are familiar with the concept of incest. Incest means marrying of same blood. That is called incest.
Yes, we have read that in Hamlet, when his mother marries with his uncle.
Incest means marrying same blood is incest. So when he studied the incest, when he studied the nature of incest, he could see that that pattern is common to many places. So there he could see some structure. So he came up with the theory that you can, this structure, the language or any human sciences can follow structure. Or language, even any, the structure doesn't need to be followed by objective human sciences. Rather, anything can have a structure of its own. When incest, it's a very basic concept, even incest follows a structure. So when you look at the relationship between people in certain communities, you can see that they can marry their uncle's daughter or uncle's son. That is a kind of incest. But in Greek, they used to marry their own brother. Cleopatra was asked to marry her own brother. That means incest was there. But that is still existing in different forms. So he could find a common pattern that connect all these, customs. So there he could find that everything follows a structure. Even human sciences have got a structure of its own. Human sciences means can be anything, art, painting, music, they all come under human sciences. Economics, history, they all come under human sciences. Earlier we used to call science only, we used to apply science only to maths, chemistry and physics and so on. So later this human sciences also came under an objective field of study. Is the idea clear? Human sciences used to be not objective at all. It was rather subjective. But with his studies, with Levi-Strauss' studies, human sciences was established as an objective area. Is the idea clear? So when you study music, or rather we can take the example of myth. If you study the myth of different locations, of different cultures, you can see that they all share some common, they all have certain things which are very common. For example, if you take the case of Santa Claus, you can see that that pattern comes again in the case of Mahabali. Have you heard of Mahabali?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
He again comes once a year to visit his subjects. Just like that, Santa Claus is a part of myth which tells us that he comes every year. Again, in the case of Krishna, these are studies which I haven't made, but these are studies which are there. There are many things that connect Krishna with Christ. Both of them were shepherds. So these are kind of links that connect the myth. So you could see that myth again come under a human science. Earlier, they were not at all objective. They were not at all autonomous. So they were not at all important also, because since they were considered a subjective, they were not given any importance in the universities. But once studies came with the conclusion that even they can be objective, these areas were taken seriously, like art or music. These areas were these areas got relevance. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, structuralism studies the structure of the system and the relationship between the members of the system. For example, if you are studying language, you are studying the structure and also studying the relationship between the sounds, words, and sentences. That is how you approach the language. That's how you approach language as a system. When you study myth as a system, you will learn all the history, all the characters, everything related to that myth, so that you will find that they all have something in common. They all share something in common. So thereby you establish that these myths share a structure. These myths have a structure. So he took anthropology as an area of his study, and he found that this anthropology, human anthropology, has got a structure. Human anthropology has got a structure, and that's how this became very famous. The structuralism got its relevance. It became very relevant. Okay? Structuralism, we study the system as it got a structure, and we also study the relationship between the members of this system. The members of the system, in case of language, would be the sounds, or can be the words, can be the sentence. Okay. Earlier language was not at all considered objective. It was just subjective, because language was part of communication. You don't need to study it. If you are exposed to it, you can speak. That is how they thought. It doesn't need to be studied. But in the 20th century, with the advent of structuralism, these ideas have changed. Universities accepted language as a separate field or objective human science. It was accepted into universities.
Yes, to purify this, to develop that.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Now moving on, what is structuralism in linguistics? Again, here we treat language as total systems or connected wholes. That means we are studying language in terms of their internal patterns of connection. That means we are finding out the internal patterns, how these sounds are connected, how these words are connected, what is the structure that is followed in a sentence. That is how we study language. We don't study language as a set of isolated items. Instead of studying language as language only in terms of phonology or in terms of morphology, we combine it. Okay. Again, in rather than focusing only on their historical sequence of development, we study language with regard to its function in the system, how it is used now. In order to speak English, you don't need to study the evolution of English, do we?
No, ma'am.
So that means we study language with regard to its function in the system rather than that historical sequence of development, rather than through their historical sequence of development.
Yes.
So these are the two important points. First thing is that instead of considering language as a set of isolated item, we study language in terms of its internal patterns of connection. Second is we study language with regard to its function and note as a note through its evolution stages.
Yes. Here.
Next, yes. Structuralism also implies an insistence on making, this is the idea I told you, it insists on making a clear distinction between historical phenomena and the characteristics of linguistic system at a given point in time. So when you study structuralism, you will see that this has to be differentiated. So you don't need to focus on how language has got evolved. Rather, you need to focus only on how language is used. What is the status of language at this given time? So there is a distinction between historical phenomena and the language, the use of language at the given point of time. Okay. We have two names for it that I'll discuss soon. Now, structural functional linguistics, the Sechourian principle. The Swiss linguist Ferdinand Sechour is known as the father of structuralism. And his publication, his famous publication, that is Course in General Linguistics. The title given here is his name, the Course D Linguistic General. The name is Course in General Linguistics, which was published in 1916 by his students who took lecture notes. He didn't publish this book, that rather it was published posthumously in the form of the lecture notes. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Then Lang and Perrot. Now we are going to see his theories in terms of some binary divisions. First binary division is Lang and Perrot. This is the first important thing. This is the first important binary division. Here he says that language can be divided as Lang and Perrot. That means language has a structure and language as speech. Language as a structure means Lang. That means it is the structure of the language, which consists of vocabulary, construction principles, of rules of construction, rules of pronunciation, etc. That is the structure of language. That is the internal pattern of language. It is the Lang. So when you express that Lang, it becomes Perrot. Clear? When you put into use, when you put the language into use, it becomes Perrot. So it is the activity of speaking in a language or actual speech. So when you use language in speech or writing, it becomes Perrot. So your knowledge of the language is the Lang and your expression of it is Perrot. Clear?
That is, Lang is in abstract form.
Language is the knowledge, is your knowledge. So your knowledge regarding rules, your knowledge regarding structure and your knowledge regarding vocabulary. In order to speak the language, you need to know the language. That knowledge is the Lang. When you speak, it becomes Perrot.
Yes.
So again, Lang is restricted in the sense that you have to follow the rules in order to come up with the right sentence. So that means Lang is restricted. While Perrot is the realm of freedom. That means you can have a different accent. You can have a different pitch. That's all. That's all up to you to decide. But in the case of Lang, you have to follow the rule. That means it is restricted. But Perrot is a realm of Perrot gives you freedom. Because there you can follow any accent you want, any dialect you want. Only thing is that the rules have to be followed. Then only it would be correct. So Lang, in case of Lang, there are restrictions. But in case of Perrot, that is completely individual. It's a realm of freedom. It is an individual act, willful and intellectual. You can use any word based on your idea. But only thing is that that word has to be accepted, or word should have that sense to convey. So this is the first important idea that was given by Sechour. The division of language is Lang and Perrot. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Next is the arbiterness of sign. We have discussed this concept before. Arbiterness of sign is there is no natural connection between the signifier and signified. Signifier is the image, while signified is the concept. Again, signifier, yes. An example is tree. Tree means letters tree doesn't have any relation to the concept tree.
Yes, ma'am.
So, but here we get sign as a combination of signifier plus signified. So we can see that sign is equal to signifier plus signified. Sign is a combination of signifier plus signified, but signifier doesn't naturally represent the signifier. There is no natural connection between the signifier and signified. Okay, so this is the second important idea. Moving on, the diachronic and synchronic study of language. Earlier when we started the structuralism in language, I've told you there are two types of language studies which are possible. One is the history-based study, and the second one is the function-based study. Right? Yes. So, synchronic study is a study of language at a given time, at a particular point of time. So, now if you are studying language with its divisions and with its rules, you will see that it is synchronic study. Now, we are studying language as part of a synchronic study. But when you study the evolution of language, evolution from Old English or from Indo-European branch, you will see that it is diachronic study. It is a study of language through its evolution. Okay, clear? So there are two types of study. One is history and one is structure. Structure-based study is what we call a synchronic study. Don't forget that. Shall we move on?
Yes.
So next is the opposite. Again, there is another binary division as syntagmatic and paradigmatic study. Syntagmatic means linear, while the other one is means it is associative. Linear means when you are combining sounds, it is in linear pattern, right? When you are combining the letter CAT, it is syntagmatic because it is a linear relationship. It represents a linear relationship. Again, this is my cat. Then the connection between this plus is auxiliary plus my pronoun plus cat, again noun, is a linear relationship. It is syntagmatic. Paradigmatic, when you try to replace these words or verbs or nouns, it becomes paradigmatic. In case of a word CAT, when you try to replace C with P, it is paradigmatic. It is associative relationship. That is how we generate new sentences and words.
Yes.
So this is my cat. It can be, again, the same pattern can be used to say, this is my rat. Generally, here is my cat. So all these patterns, all these sentence formations are possible just because that is how the structure of language is. So paradigmatic is associative, while syntagmatic is the linear relationship. So syntagmatic means we need to have a linear pattern, then only we can replace it. So this replaceive relationship is paradigmatic. The real relationship, it is syntagmatic. When you try to replace those linearly arranged patterns, it becomes paradigmatic. Okay, clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Now we are moving on to the next important area. See, sometimes you can have a question like American structuralism or Bloomfield. Okay, so in that case, you have to focus more on American structuralism. But for that also, you need to give an introduction to structuralism. What is structuralism? And also give, also try to write something about Sechler, because he is the father of structuralism. But Bloomfield is the father of American structuralism. Anyway, now we are going to see the difference between American structuralism and European structuralism. In American structuralism, we will see the capacity. Anyway, we study the structure, and we will also see the elements of that structure and the capacity of these elements for association and substitution, as we saw in the case of paradigmatic relationship. Okay, in what all ways they can be replaced? In what all ways they can be combined? This is what we study in American structuralism. Clear? While a European linguist will tell you, this is how a sentence can be arranged. And there is this connection between these words. This is how a European linguist will teach you. But in case of an American structuralist, they will tell you how can they be connected, how can be they combine and how can they be replaced? Is clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Is it clear to everyone?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, moving on. Yes, so ma'am. We have Burr, Sapper, and Bloomfield. They are all pioneers of American structuralism. And the towering figure is, of course, it's Bloomfield. They are the pioneers of American structuralism. And we'll start with Edward Sapper. Anyway, he started with his studies in Takelma, which is an American Indian language. Again, we can say that his ideas predated the Saussurean principles of structuralism. For him, what makes him different was, for him, language was a communicative activity. It is a product of history. Then he also explained language in terms of its structure. And he also said that language, structure of language is universal, which was later explained by Chomsky. He said that every language has got a structure. They all have a universal structure. Every language shares a universal structure. Anyway, one more feature that distinguishes Sapper from Bloomfield is his emphasis on mentalism. He said that language is mentalistic, or his approach was more mentalistic compared to the mechanistic approach of Bloomfield. Bloomfield's approach was completely mechanistic, while he gave importance to the mindset of the speaker. Anyway, he was part of a hypothesis which is known as Sapper work hypothesis that we will discuss towards the end of this blog. Okay. He's one of the pioneers of American structuralism. And his most important idea is he conceived language as having a universal structure. Then also he emphasized on the mentalistic nature of language. Or mentalistic, he also gave importance to the mindset of the speaker. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Shall we move on? Next is Leonard Bloomfield. So his ideas, his theories are related to behaviorism and psychology. Those who studied B.Ed. would understand it better. So in his book, Language, he formulated his mechanistic approach that is based on stimulus response. You might have studied stimulus response theory, which is part of behaviorism. And for him, if you have a stimulus that gives rise to a response, if you want an apple, definitely the response would be, if no one is there, you would go and find the apple. You go and get the apple. If someone is there, if Jack, just like Jack and Jill. So if you are Jack and if you are hungry, you would tell Jill that you want an apple. Then that will act as a stimulus to Jill, and Jill will go and fetch that apple for you. That's why we have stimulus S capital, that is the stimulus. Then response, small response means it acted like a stimulus. That response acted as a stimulus to Jill, and that further came in the form of his reaction. He goes the apple for you. That means that is a capital R. That means any stimulus generated the response. S gives rise to the capital R.
Yes, ma'am.
Did you understand the concept? Final product will always be capital R. So this is stimulus response schema. If you are hungry, you would say, this is his idea. If you are hungry, you would say, I am hungry. Or you would go and get some food. These are the responses that can be expected. This is a behaviorist principle. Anyway, he marked a definite shift from mentalism. His ideas marked a definite shift from mentalism and physicalism, mentalism to physicalism. He completely ignored the mentalistic aspect of the speaker. That is why he is known as an apostle of anti-mentalism. And he placed a very heavy emphasis on objective observation. Objective means the subjectivity was not at all given any importance. So anyway, he also completely ignored the theories of meaning, because he considered meaning as a mentalistic construct. So if you want to consider meaning, you have to consider the culture, you have to consider many other factors. For example, if I tell rose, if I give you the word rose, some of you would be thinking of the flower rose, some of you would be thinking of thinking of the color rose, some would be thinking of the name rose. So it can have multiple significations. So considering meaning is absurd. That is what he thought, Leonard Bloomfield. Okay, because meaning,
Sorry, yes.
Ma'am, what is this mentalism?
Mentalism means you are giving importance to the mindset.
Okay, ma'am.
Signification based on mind, or the response based on mind.
So basically, from mentalism to physicalism means getting some stimulation and then acting on it.
Acting on it, exactly. So it is completely based on behavior. So your mind has no role at all. If you are hungry, you'll go and eat something. So it can be predicted. So he never considers the idea that if you are hungry, you won't say it. You simply suppress the hunger. That is mentalism. You are giving importance to your mind because you understand that there is only a small amount of food and that food is for your kids, so you can't take it. If you consider that way, that is mentalism. You are giving importance to your mind. You are thinking through your thinking. You are giving importance to your thought. But the behaviorism tells you that your response will be in terms of action. That is behaviorism. In case of language, if you want to say something, this is how you are going to say it. These are the words that will come out of your mouth. If you are hungry, you would say, I'm hungry.
Ma'am, is it means stimulus and responses constitute a language irrespective of individuals?
Individual's mindset, exactly.
Okay.
Okay. There is no subjectivity at all. That is why it... yes?
Ma'am, what does small r and small s represent in stimulus response schema?
See, that is what I explained through the example of Jack and Jill. So if you are hungry, either you will go and get the apple for yourself, or you can tell your mom to get food for you.
Yes.
Anyway, the stimulus is that you are hungry, you need to eat something. Response is you get the food. So either you can take the food directly, or you can tell your mom to get food for you. So that small r is your response is you are telling your mom. So that response will be acting as a stimulus for your mother. Then finally the response will be she'll get you food. Okay, clear? Either S gives rise to R, or S, R, S, capital R. The final product will be capital R. That if you are hungry, you'll eat food. Okay.
Yes,
so there is no possibility like you'll suppress your hunger. That is what I told you, that it was completely physical. It was completely objective. Again, another point is that he completely ignored meaning, because for him, meaning was a construct. Meaning is a construct rather, because you can't guess the meaning of a particular meaning of a particular word, because that will have infinite implications. That can have many significations based on the mindset of the speaker, based on the culture of the speaker, based on the experience of the speaker. The meaning varies. If I say water, you would be thinking of drinking water. Some of you would be thinking of rain. Some of you would be thinking of a sea. Some of you would be thinking of something else, a picture. So you can have different meanings based on your culture, your experience, and so on. That's why he completely ignored the idea of meaning. So he took meaning as an unobservable mentalistic construct. That is how he took the concept of meaning. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Again, as I told you, he was the father of American structuralism. So he had many followers, and American linguistics was basically based on his principles. So they hold on to his principle for quite a long time. They completely ignored meaning. Then they resorted to co-occurrence. Co-occurrence means the combination, the way they can come, the way the elements can come in a language or in a structure. So they focused more on combinations and associations that we will see. So on the basis of distribution of the units of linguistic structure, there are three types of distributional relationship. So I told you, they basically studied the distribution and association. Their ideas are based on distribution and association of the elements in a structure. So let us see the three types of distribution. First one is complementary distribution, second is contrastive distribution, and third one is free variation.
So complementary distribution can be explained using the concept of allophones and allomorphs. That's why I told you that I will take this unit after block 3. Because in order to understand allophones, you should know what are allophones. I hope you know already. You already know what are allophones, don't you?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
The different sound variations of the same phoneme is an allophone. Aspirated versions, different aspirated varieties of the same sound is an allophone. So look at the example. In English, the phoneme P has two variants, the aspirated and the unaspirated. That means when where one unit occurs, the other does not occur. So in the place of an, so whenever P comes in the initial position and in a stressed position, it is always aspirated. So unaspirated P will never come in that position. Clear? Similarly, allomorph also. When a word ends with a voiceless sound, and when you are using that ed, when you are using the past tense form of that word, a voiceless sound will always take another voiceless sound. So we'll get cats. And do you remember that cats s sound? In case of dog, it is z. In case of horse, it is horses. They are all allomorphs. Allomorphs of the same sound, sir. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Is the idea clear?
Ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So this yes, is ma'am. Complementary distribution. When one unit occurs, the other does not occur in the same place. Next is contrastive distribution. Again, when you you can replace a sound with another sound so that it can produce a change in meaning. Example, when you replace C with P, it becomes pat. So there is a change of meaning. Again, when you replace T with P, it becomes cap instead of cat. Okay, so this is called a contrastive distribution. Complementary distribution means the two units do not occur in the same position. In case of contrastive distribution, when you change a sound, you'll get another word with another meaning. Okay? Minimal pairs means there is change only in case of one sound. That is a minimal pair. For example, cap and cat, it's a minimal pair. Mat and sat, it's a minimal pair. Okay? Clear?
Yeah,
minimal
pair, one more time.
Minimal pair means there is a change only in one sound. Two words, there are pairs of words with change only in one sound.
That can cat, be a verb or a consonant.
It can be anything.
Okay, ma'am. Okay, thank you.
So, complementary distribution. Again.
Complementary distribution means, see, when one unit occurs, that means in case of allomorphs and allophones, when where one unit occurs, the other variation doesn't occur in the same place. See, in case of Pat or in case of Peter and police, you will see that both words use the sound P. But in case of police, it is unaspirated. So it is the allophone, the same allophone. That means both are allophonic variations of the same sound P. But in case of Peter, it is aspirated per sound. But in case of police, it is unaspirated.
Okay.
That means we got two sounds, but with different variations of the same sound is used. So that means one unit can occur only under certain conditions. Only if it is unaspirated that we will use the P sound. If it is aspirated, we always use the aspirated version, that is P. The other one is P. Clear?
Clear.
Last one is free variation, where unit occur in the same environment along with no change in meaning. Example is either. Either can be either or either. Advertisement can be advertisement or advertisement. So they occur in the same environment along with no change in meaning. Both can be used. It is free variation. That's an example of free variation. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Can we move on? Any doubt? These three are the important distributional relations according to Secher. Not Secher, Bloomfield. A complementary distribution, contrasted distribution, and free variation. Because these are important because they basically focus on the distributional relationship. American structuralism focuses on the distributional relationship, the capacity of the elements for association and distribution. I hope you remember the definition. How can they be combined? How can they be replaced? So these ideas explain you how can they be combined, how can they be replaced. Shall we continue?
Yes, ma'am.
So next last one is discovery procedure that I have taken from your textbook essays. So he says that the purpose of a linguist is to come up with some grammar for the language under study. So for that, he should first have a corpus. Corpus is his objective material. What is his objective? So based on his objective, he will come up with a linguistic theory, and that linguistic theory will lay down the rules for the language that will be acted as the grammar for the system. Okay, clear? This has to be the purpose, or this has to be the aim of a linguist. So through using discovery procedure will tell you how to generate grammar. How can you generate grammar for language? First of all, you need to have an objective. With that objective, based on that objective, you will come up with a linguistic theory. And through that linguistic theory, you will generate grammar, rules of grammar. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Moving on, Bloomfieldian methodology. So this is how he distinguished the structure. First one is phonemics. We'll start with phonemics. So this is the first level of operation, phonemics. So, you know, it's a sounds. Basic sounds are called, the basic sounds will come under phonemics. In morphemics, we will see the combination of sounds. Then we have syntax. Syntax, thereby we study the structure of sentence, and finally we will get the discourse that will create larger sentences, or finally we'll get the language for speech. So these are the four layered system according to Bloomfield. This is his method. We'll start with phonemics, then he'll get into morphemes, then we have syntax, and finally we'll have the discourse.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now another important theory coming up, that is IC analysis, immediate constituent analysis. So this was introduced by Bloomfield in 1933. Again, here what we are going to see is we are going to divide the sentence into layers, small layers, and we'll keep on dividing the sentence until we reach the smallest constituent. Smallest constituent means it can be a single word, or can be any meaningful part of the word, can be even an article, can be any meaningful part. Okay, you will reach the smallest divisible word. You keep on dividing a sentence until you get the smallest divisible word. That is called IC analysis. I have given you a sentence, the old man ran away. So the first division would be old man and ran away. The old man, it is a noun phrase. Ran away is the verb phrase, right? The subject is the old man. Ran away is the verb. Okay? Isn't it so?
Yes, ma'am.
So the old man, again, we are going to divide the old man as
old and man.
First one would be
old.
Adjective and noun.
Adjective and noun. Then we'll get article the. Then final division would be the article, old, adjective, and man, the noun. Again, in the case of ran away, we'll get the division ran
and adverb.
Away is the
preposition.
Away.
Adverb.
It's adverb, exactly. So you get the adverb away. So you got five constituents. One is article, then you got the adjective, then noun, then verb, then adverb. That's how you got the constituents. This is how you divide a sentence. Now let us see. How can you divide a noun phrase? Old men and women. This is a noun phrase, right? It's not a complete sentence. It's just a phrase. Old men and women. So the first classification would be old, which is applicable to both men and women. So look at the box. So you can see two divisions possible from this particular sentence. One is old, the adjective old applicable to both men and women. So we will see the first division based on the adjective applicable to both men and women. Correct? Am I right?
Yes.
Yes.
So look at the divisions, old, so applicable to men and women. So the second, first in the second box, we saw that men and women are included in a box. Then we will see the next division as men, noun, then conjunction and women, again, noun. Then second division, look at the second box. I see analysis based on another division. Thereby, we see that old is applicable only to men. So the division, we have a different division here, because here old is applicable only to men. So we'll get old men and women. Here the division is different because that adjective is applicable only to men. That's why we have a different division, different type of division. Okay, clear?
Yes, ma'am.
This is IC analysis. So we will see in IC analysis, we will see how can we divide the constituents, and we will finally get the last constituent, that is the immediate constituent, that is to understand the immediate constituents. What are the elements that the sentence constitutes? Next one is generative linguistics. So we were discussing American structuralism. Then now we are going to see generative linguistics. So again, the advocate of generative linguistics, Noam Chomsky. Again, it's a school of thought within linguistics. It is he who comes up with the concept of generative grammar. His important book is Syntactic Structures. And he is famous for his TG grammar, that is Transformational Generative Grammar. So these are the concepts which he is associated with. Generative linguistics, Chomsky's ideas about language, and pre-structured grammar, PSG. That is another extension of IC analysis. Then we have TG grammar. He came up with TG grammar to replace pre-structured grammar. We will soon see how it is. Chomsky's ideas about language. This is how he defines language. It's a set of sentences, each finite in length and constructed out of a finite set of elements. Again, it is a system represented in the mind. Again, that is very important. It is a system represented in the mind or brain of a particular individual. So you could see that he gave importance to the mind of the reader. Sorry, mind of the speaker. Then again, he had always wanted to come up with the idea of universal grammar. Earlier we saw that Sapper stated that you can see certain elements which are universal, but he always wanted to come up with an idea called universal grammar. So what do you mean by universal grammar? Universal grammar means the rules that are common to all human languages, the rules or principles which are common to every language. So if you study Malayalam or if you study Hindi, there are many common elements, there are many common rules. And if you study the rules of every language, you will see there are certain rules which are common to each and every language. So he thought if he studies those common rules, he will be able to come up with a universal grammar. So once you understand the universal grammar, you can approach each and every language. Okay. So every language...
Is it possible to develop a universal grammar? Is anyone tried to develop it?
Chomsky did try.
Developed a universal grammar?
He tried to come up with something called universal grammar. He tried, that was his objective.
Is he successful in it?
No, he wasn't successful, but still, because he couldn't study all the languages. That is again a very difficult task. But he tried to come up with certain ideas.
But in Indian languages, it's possible. The structure of our languages are same. But
there are certain things, at least a classification, the division of elements as nouns, verbs, and those things are similar.
Okay. Ma'am, there is a very good similarity of past tense and present tense in Hindi also. It's same in both the languages.
Yeah. In Indian languages, it is possible, but there are languages like haiku and also there are. I don't remember the name of the language, but there is a language whereby those people do not have any distinction as past tense and present tense. So they don't have past tense at all. They don't have expressions like yesterday or last year. They don't have anything that they can show the past form. So they don't have any past form at all. So there is no division of time as past, present, and future. Rather, they consider language time as something which is flowing.
Which language is that?
I think it's a Redina language. It's coming. We'll see.
Okay.
So the concept of universal grammar, whereby he tried to come up with a common universal grammar so that you can study all human languages. Then again, that is based on his idea that human beings share part of their knowledge of language, which is universal grammar. So we all have a knowledge of language, that is slang, which is universal. Okay, existing as part of language competence, or we can rather say that it is part of our lang. So we all share our knowledge of language, which is universal. Because we follow certain rules, whatever be the language that we use language based on certain rules, and those rules can be universal. So every man knows, like every human beings know a set of principles that apply to all languages and parameters that vary within clearly defined limits from one language to another. So when you study a second language, you will first try to compare that language with your language. Then you will try to find out the divisions, what all ways this language differ from your language. So that is what is meant by parameters that vary within clearly defined limits. So you will understand that. So in this particular, in case of this language, this is the structure which it follows, which is different from the structure of my language, which follows this particular structure. Okay. That the speaker is already aware of. He knows a set of principles that apply to all languages. At least he would know that this division of elements as nouns, words, nouns, verbs, and so on are common to all languages. Because in every language, people will be given a name. At least that is common. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
So the use of proper nouns or common nouns are common. I'm just giving an example. Then we can say that universal grammar is an attempt to integrate grammar, mind, and language. Here he is focusing on not just on the rules of grammar, rather he is also focusing on the mind and language. That is what differentiates Chomsky from other American structuralists. Let us see his ideas about syntax. Again, he says that language is structure dependent, just like all other structuralists. Syntax again, he endorses this point also, that is more than meaning. He also doesn't consider meaning that much. So rather, he thinks that language relies on the structural relationship in the sentence rather than on the sequence of words. So it is basically a relationship between the structure, it's not just a sequence of words, rather the relationship, the signification is based on the structure, not the words. Okay, again, he doesn't give importance to meaning. Example, the man who stole is John. Is the man who stole John? Which one is correct? Here, the meaning is based not on the combination of words, rather, it is based on the structure. Only if you ask this particular question, that the sentence will be correct. Otherwise, you won't be able to give the correct signification. Is the man who stole is John? Can you ask the question like that?
No.
Yeah.
Which one is correct?
The first one.
The man who was told is John.
Yeah.
Is the man who was told John? It's also, but last one is not a person. Is the man who told is John? It's not a correct way. So we understood that it is dependent on structure. The signification is dependent on structure, not the words. Okay. Then we came to the conclusion that it is more than meaning. So there can be sentences, there can be well-formed sentences without meaning. Colorless, green, ideas sleep furiously. Again, it is meaning deprived of inner logic.
See, look at the first sentences. Colorless, green, idea, sleep, furious. It is a perfectly complete sentence, because colorless, green, ideas, there is nothing wrong with the sentence. Colorless, green, ideas, sleep, furiously. Then in that case, we might think that, how can it convey sense then? If it is not just about meaning. Then, so in order to understand whether this is a possible combination, you have to ask the native speaker. That is what he has to tell you. In order to understand whether a language, whether a particular sentence is acceptable or not, you have to ask the native speaker. If it is acceptable to the native speaker, this is logically correct. So there also he says that you should not rely on the meaning. The meaning is decided by the people who use the language.
Yes, okay? The native people actually.
Native people. So it's a well-formed sentence without meaning. Look at the second sentence example. Syntax as well as meaning deprived of inner logic. In the second sentence, there is no syntax, there is no semantics. Ideas furiously, green, colorless, sleep. But the first one is structurally correct. The second one lacks both logic as well as syntax. Then Chomsky's ideas, competence and performance, which is similar to Lang and Parole. Almost is similar to Lang and Parole. So it is he who came up with this idea of competence and performance. Competence is your knowledge of language. Isn't it just like Lang? Your knowledge, your unconscious knowledge of the language, about sounds, meanings and syntax. Every human child is born with an LAD, language acquisition device. So he has that idea of language. He has that knowledge of language. He has the knowledge of the structure of language.
Mother tongue.
Mother tongue.
Yes.
So every child is born with an LAD, language acquisition device. So when he is exposed to a particular language, of course that will start working. The device is there within you. Once you start giving something, when you start giving the input, definitely it starts working.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, that is how it becomes part of your experience. Then next one is performance. How do you put that knowledge into use? That is performance. It is similar to Lang and Parole. Competence and performance.
Yes.
When we term these ideas under Chomsky, it becomes competence and performance. Then models of grammar. Then these are the three important models of grammar proposed by Chomsky. Finite state grammar, free structure grammar, TG grammar. Second, the free structure grammar and transformational generative grammar are very important to us.
The American structuralism, if the question is coming, then Chomsky also will write.
No. See, you just mentioned Chomsky, but I think he'll be asked as a separate question. Because you will be asked to write about generative grammar or Chomsky.
Yes, ma'am.
If they ask you, but he is also a part of American structuralism, even though he came up with different ideas. So you can just mention Chomsky. It's a way of conclusion.
Yes, about a little bit you can write.
A little bit you can. Later, Chomsky came up with something called a TG grammar, transformational generative grammar.
Yes, ma'am.
Which were different in many aspects, like then you can write down a few points.
Yes, ma'am.
Actually, IC analysis and phrase structure grammar are connected. Phrase structure grammar is an extension of IC analysis by Bloomfield. While he uses a tree diagram, he uses an inverted tree diagram. That is the difference.
While Chomsky used an inverted diagram.
Chomsky used an inverted diagram, tree diagram. See, he started with revision. Rather, he started with the rules first. Then he went on to label the sentence. But Bloomfield started with the sentence. Then he, later only he labeled it.
Yes, ma'am.
That is the difference. So one's approach was deductive, while the other approach was inductive. You will see that soon. Models of grammar. So these are the three models of grammar he introduced. Finite state grammar, free structure grammar, and TG grammar. So the last two are important to us, phrase structure grammar. So he gave us rules for determining the structure of phrases. Again, so with these rules, if you have the rules with you, you can generate a lot of sentences from a small number of rules. That is the difference between Chomsky and Bloomfield. Bloomfield gave you a sentence, then he divided the sentence into small constituents. But once you have the rules, once you know the rules, you'll be able to generate sentences of your own. That was Chomsky's idea. Why do you need to take an example, then start labeling? Then why can't you start with rules first? Then you can generate many sentences out of the rules. Clear? Is idea clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Then the structure of a phrase will consist of one or more constituents in a certain order. So you can divide a sentence into different phrases, and each phrase will have one or more constituents in a certain order. What would be that order? For example, in the case of noun phrase, you will have an article followed by an adjective, then followed by a noun. That is how the order of a phrase would be in case of a noun phrase. So you will see the example. Some words seem to belong together. The crazy man is jumping off the bridge. Look at the constituents here. Let's take the first constituent, noun phrase. Let's first divide the sentence into a phrase, noun phrase and verb phrase. What is the noun phrase there?
The crazy man.
Exactly. Or we rather divide the sentence in subject and predicate. That is the general division that we all know, the subject and the predicate. Here the subject is the crazy man, and is jumping off the bridge is the predicate. So now we are going to an advanced level. We label it as noun phrase and verb phrase. That which acts as a noun will be the noun phrase, and the part of the group of words which constitute the verb part would be the verb phrase. So the crazy man, in the crazy man, we will see the article, the crazy adjective, and man, the noun. Similarly, in jumping off the bridge also, you will see again, verb auxiliary, then jumping off, it's a phrasal verb, then the article, then bridge noun. Again, in the last division, in the second division, you will again get a noun phrase. What is the noun phrase in that verb phrase?
Bridge.
The bridge. Again, you get another noun phrase, right? The bridge. That is now the noun phrase. So here, noun phrase comes as part of a verb phrase. That is, he is jumping off the bridge. Let's take another example. Phrase structure rules and tree diagram. See, if you know the rules, I told you that you will be able to generate a sentence. Noun phrase can be determiner plus noun, and prepositional phrase can be a preposition plus a noun phrase. So noun phrase can be determiner plus noun, and a prepositional phrase can be preposition plus noun phrase. See, I have taken only a noun phrase here. So that big noun phrase can be divided as a noun phrase plus a prepositional phrase. Do you get the idea?
Yes.
For example, I am taking the example of the boy in the yard is my friend. The boy in the yard called me. Isn't it a complete sentence? Isn't it a complete sentence? So I'm taking only the first part, so that it's a noun phrase. The boy in the yard, it's a noun phrase. I'm again dividing the noun phrase as noun. So we get the noun phrase as noun phrase is equal to the noun phrase, the boy, plus prepositional phrase. Prepositional phrase means the phrase, it starts with a preposition. Here the preposition is in. So we get the answer. It's a prepositional phrase is in the yard. Mm-hmm. So noun phrase is equal to another noun phrase plus prepositional phrase. So here we get the noun phrase as the article, the, and boy. See, look at the division there. Determiner, noun, prepositional phrase. So determiner is again the article. It determines the noun. How many? So there is only the boy. So a, and the, this, that, they're all determiners that determine the number. They're called determiners because it determines the noun. Clear? So okay, the boy in the yard can be divided as determiner plus noun plus prepositional phrase. Again, when you divide the prepositional phrase, you get preposition in plus another noun phrase, the yard. Again, that noun phrase consists of a determiner and another noun, yard. Clear?
Clear.
So you have generated the rules first. Then based on these rules, you can generate as many sentences as you want. So you can generate other sentences which follow the same order. The boy in the yard, the girl in the class, the lady in the hotel, the man in the crowd. So you can generate many sentences. Is it clear? But in the case of immediate constituent analysis, in the case of ICE analysis, we first started with the sentence instead of the rules. That is the difference between phrase structure, grammar, and immediate constituent analysis. Isn't it an inverted diagram? Again, another example. I hope you understood it now. See, first one, we have seen a noun phrase. This is a case of a verb phrase. So here verb phrase is equal to verb plus noun phrase plus another prepositional phrase. Take the last sentence, verb phrase, take your sister to the library. What is the order there? Take your sister, so you please take your sister to the library. If that is a sentence, you take your sister to the library as a verb phrase. The whole sentence, the whole group of words is a verb phrase, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Then you are again going to divide the verb phrase as verb plus another noun phrase. Your sister is another noun phrase plus to the library. It's a prepositional phrase. So you got verb phrase here means verb plus noun phrase plus prepositional phrase. Right? Am I right?
Yes.
Again, noun phrase here is your sister. That is a combination of a determiner plus noun. Again, to the library is a combination of preposition to plus another noun phrase, the library. Again, that noun phrase consists of a determiner, the plus noun library. Is it getting clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
I hope all of you understood phrase structure grammar.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, moving on. So these are the phrase structure rules. Sentence can be a combination of, sentence is a combination of a noun phrase plus verb phrase. Noun phrase, as we saw in the earlier cases, it's a combination of a determiner plus noun, or it can be also a pronoun. Then VP, verb phrase can be a combination of verb plus noun phrase plus prepositional phrase, even adverb. Then prepositional phrase is equal to preposition plus noun phrase, and adjective phrase is equal to, or adverb phrase is equal to adverb plus preposition. We'll see the examples. See, this is the example given in your textbook. Sentence is equal to noun phrase plus verb phrase. The man hit the ball. You can see the rules. Noun phrase is equal to article plus noun, the man. Then verb phrase is equal to verb plus noun phrase. Here the verb is, verb here is hit plus noun phrase is equal to the ball. So the ball is again a combination of determiner plus noun. Instead of article, you can write determiner, D-E-T. Okay. Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
But there are certain limitations with phrase structure grammar. Anyway, the rules are mostly context-free. You won't be able to always consider the signification. They're context-free. You can generate as many sentences with this order. Then again, The rules explain intra-sentence constituent elements, but not inter-sentence relation. That means you can explain the sentences, the relation of the sentence, relations of words within a sentence, but you won't be able to explain the connection of different sentences, as in the case of combining sentences with conjunctions. Okay? You'll be able to explain the sentence, the connection of words within a sentence, but you won't be able to explain the connection of words within two sentences, or when you connect a sentence with another sentence, you won't be able to explain the relationship. Similarly, ambiguous sentences cannot be explained. For example, there are sentences whereby you comes as a subject. So, for example, get up, shut up, get out. When you make these type of sentences, it is so ambiguous because there is no subject at all. Even though the subject is understood, we don't use the sentence. We don't use it in a speech. So that it is very difficult to explain these kind of sentences, imperative sentence. Clear? In imperative sentences, there won't be subject because it is understood. The subject is already understood. Because the subject is always you. That kind of sentences cannot be explained using phrase structure grammar. Because we have the formula that sentence is equal to noun phrase plus verb phrase. But since we don't find noun phrase, we won't understand the pattern of the sentence. Clear? Is it clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So these problems were solved with next step, that is transformational generative grammar. So there were many drawbacks for this phrase structure grammar. So he came up with transformational generative grammar to address these drawbacks. Let us see TG grammar. Shall we see TG grammar? Do we have time? Let's see. Deep and structured surface. I'll take some more time. deep and surface structures. So again, this is a concept by Chomsky. Syntactic relationship have two levels of representation, as we have seen, and as we have seen in the case of competence and performance, there is a surface structure and there's a deep structure. Deep structure is the underlying representation. So you know that you know the basic structure of a sentence, and you generate new sentences out of that basic sentence, and that basic sentence is called a deep structure. And sentences that you generate out of this basic sentence are called sentences which belong to deep structure. For example, if I make a positive sentence, I know the order, that is subject verb. I know. Okay, this is the sentence I know. But when I want to make a negative sentence, I make a sentence out of this deep structure. So I will say I don't know. Even when I want to make a question, I will say do I know. That they are all structures which I have created out of this deep structure. Is the idea clear? So negative sentences, questions, all these are, then again passive voice, all these are created out of this deep structure. So there is an underlying structure, and from that we create new structures, and that underlying structure is the deep structure, and that derived representation and the surface that we derived out of this deep structure is the surface structure. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Now, deep structure is an abstract level of structural organization, but surface structure can be derived from deep structure by transformation like passivization, forming questions, negatives. They are all derived out of this deep structure. Okay. So these are all examples. Charlie broke the window. How they are related? Let us look at the connection. The window was broken by Charlie broke the window. It is the deep structure. The window was broken by Charlie. Again, it's the surface structure. Was the window broken by Charlie? Another surface structure. Charlie who broke the window, it's not complete. Then we can say that Charlie didn't break the window. It is another surface structure. So difference in their surface structure is equal to difference in syntactic form. So when I created different structures, there was a difference in their forms also, but they have a same underlying structure. That means Charlie, then the verb break, and the noun the window, the object the window. Is it clear? And the sentence is in past tense. Charlie broke the window. This is the basic structure. From that I could derive passive voice, then negative sentence and a question also. Did Charlie break the window? Charlie didn't break the window. The window was broken by Charlie. All these surface structures were derived out of the deep structure. Charlie broke the window. Next is TG grammar. Do we have time to start TG grammar? Shall we deal it in the next class?
Okay, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, next class, I will also start block 2. That is history of language. I won't be taking too much time for it. Once I finish it, I'll move on to it. But the only thing is that it is quite boring, I should tell you, because there are, it is easy, but the only thing is that it's very boring because old English spelling, the changes in spelling, the changes in grammar and so on are not that easy to digest because they are old English and the words are not that familiar to us. So you may find it as very boring, but I'm really helpless. Only thing you can do is so you can read it and come
ma'am.
To class. Yes.
Ma'am, when will be the next class?
Maybe next Saturday and Sunday.
Time?
Time, same time. I think 4 to 6 will be followed.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
That's what we are planning. I don't think the time has been fixed, but I have told coordinator that next week will be okay for me. Maybe she'll fix it same time. I don't know. Let's see.
Okay, okay.
Ma'am, what was stylistic block 9?
That also I'll take. I'll take stylistics, okay, syntax and stylistics, both blocks. I won't be dealing the other blocks.
Okay, ma'am.
That is easy to understand. Only that syntax part is a bit difficult. When stylistics is easy, so syntax is the syntax is a bit difficult part. All the rest are very easy. Oh. Don't you find it so?
Okay, ma'am. Yeah.
Syntax is also easy for those who know grammar. Many of you are very adamant, very well-versed in grammar, because when I ask, you were giving response. So I understood that many of you have very good foundation for grammar. So those people won't find it difficult at all, because it's very easy.
Yeah, ma'am.
Others who have got some problem with grammar would find it a bit difficult, because it's basically about grammar. It is syntax, that means structure. That's all about grammar.
Ma'am, which topics will you be dealing with in the next class?
Second block, that is history of language. That's why what I told you, it's going to be a bit boring. Okay.
Yeah,
because
I'll
it's
in fact good reading.
The changes in Old English spelling, grammar and vocabulary. So if you read it and come for the next class, it would be easier for me.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Then thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Ma'am, thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Share this PPT or do I need to share it after the next class?
Thank you.
When is the next class? Next class will be probably by the Saturday.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, then. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.